طيب، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه، أما بعد. The last قاعدة that we been studying is in the bait قال وترجع الأحكام لليقين فلا يزيل الشك لليقين. And this is all the ahkam, all the rules goes back to certainty, and doubt will not be able to or cannot remove the yaqeen. And this is the qa'ida that the scholar called al-yaqeenu la yazulu bil-shakki. Al-yaqeenu la yazulu bil-shakki. Yaqeen cannot be removed by the shak, bar the doubt. And we have gave the example, like the example of at-tahara, cleanliness, that someone, if he's certain that he's in a state of wudu, for example, and then before the prayer he start to have doubt, so those doubts will not be removing his wudu or obligate him to redo his wudu, because he's certain that he make wudu and he's doubtful that he break the wudu. Then we said the conclusion is the doubt of breaking the wudu could not revoke the certainty of have made, or like that person has already made the wudu, so he will not do his wudu. The hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that we have mentioned last time, he said someone might feel something during his salah, and he might think that he, you know, has some air like past. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, whoever who feels such a thing during his salah, he should continue unless he will hear a sound or he will smell a kind of the smell. So when someone smells something, he knows certainly. So you see the two examples of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, you know, to avoid you know, to be distracted, you only build your opinion on certainty. Someone feel like he have blotting in his stomach, anything that he broke his wudu. So the Prophet said, قَالَ فَلَا يَنْصَرِفُ حَتَّى يَسْمَعْ صَوْتًا أَنْ يَشُمَّ أَوْ يَشُمَّ رَائِحًا. So he should not leave the prayer unless he will certain. And certainty, the Prophet described it. Did you hear a sound? Did you smell anything? So stay in your prayer. And I have said also that this qa'ida is also applied even in aqidah. Applied in aqidah. For example, when someone he's Muslim, certainly Muslim, he said, you know, the shahada, the testimony of faith, saying La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah, and he's a Muslim. Then this person, if he does anything conflicting with the shahada, conflicting with the, you know, the spirit of Islam, he cannot be denounced and announced to be someone who void his iman. Imam Shafi'i is saying in this beautiful statement, based on this principle, on this qaida, on this maxim, he's saying, qala, whoever who came to Islam with yaqeen, we cannot you know, judge or have a ruling against him to become non-Muslim by doubt. Said, oh, we saw him doing this, he's non-Muslim anymore. Said, that's wrong. Because the yaqeen, and the yaqeen in these cases require two things. Iqamatul hujja wa intifa'ul mawana. Iqamatul hujja is to establish the full proof and evidence that this person, he's conflicting with the requirement of La ilaha illallah. And intifa'ul mawana, that this person, he's not under any kind of condition or circumstances or restriction, you know, making him to do such a thing. So, for example, mawana is saying, do you know that this, because one of the mawana is ignorance. He might be not knowing what he's doing that is forbidden. So intifa'ul mawana and iqamatul hujja. So these, I mean, is a very important principle in the Islamic jurisprudence which is al-yaqin la yuzalu bil-shak. And one of this, you know, of the great benefit of this principle is to help the believer be focused and firm in his action and in his doing. Because when someone get in the trap of the whispering of the shaitan, subhanallah, this trap, it has an endless tricks. Someone in his tahara, he's always like doubting if he has a tahara or not, if his clothes are clean or not, if his salat is accepted, if he's did, you know, subhanallah. There is a book of al-Imam Ibn al-Jawzi, and even a book also of Ibn Taymiyyah, rahimahumullahu ta'ala, jami'an, talking about this fact, whereas people, subhanallah, being trapped by the shaitan in the whispering, they cannot even pray anymore. They cannot pray anymore. There's one who's you know, heard you know, how to pronounce some of the letters in Surah Al-Fatiha, and make this person to, you know, hearing himself believe that he's not saying it right. So he kept saying "Wala dhalin" for almost, you know, 5 to 10 minutes, trying to correct it. And so he didn't pass the first rak'ah, just to try to correct "La dhalin," that in his mind is not does not rhyme exactly as the way he heard it from the teacher. And this is whispering of the shaitan. This is so to avoid such a thing, to have the focus and the khushu'. Someone, you know, whatever he learned, he knows that he will go through it if he's certain that he has wudu, continue unless something certain happen that revoke that state that he believe he's in. طيب. يقول هنا فائدة. قال اليقين لا يزال بالشك لها موردان. اليقين لا يزال بالشك. This principle or maxim that yaqeen cannot, certainty cannot be removed by the doubt. It has two sources. The first source, that استصحاب الأصلي. استصحاب الأصل. We have in the as also principle in the usul of al-fiqh. استصحاب الأصل أو قاعدة الاستصحاب. قاعدة الاستصحاب. قاعدة الاستصحاب. It is the fact that someone he is, for example, in a state of observing. Will not have an example, but someone he's a Muslim, you know, he's a Muslim. So the this attribute, this characteristic of being a Muslim, it will be accompanying this person wherever he is, you know. So if something happened, say, oh, we saw that person, you know, he's like, he must be, for example, you know, following this faith. He said, no, he's a Muslim. I know him, he's a Muslim. That's certainty. So istishab is that the hukum or what the person is observing, it will be accompanying that person in all his state. If someone, for example, started, you know, I mean, I don't have in my mind like example in some of the, it might be also whatever, for example, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make the alcohol haram, you know. In whatever circumstances, the ruling of the prohibition of the alcohol will be accompanying the alcohol wherever it goes, whatever it used for. So for example, we say, okay, so using consuming alcohol is haram. We are putting in medication. He said, it's also the ruling of the hurma will be accompanying the alcohol wherever you're gonna put it. So that's istishab. So for example, say, oh, this person is gonna drink it, he's gonna use it in this thing. He said, the ruling is related to the item itself, to the product itself, is not to the use. So this is, we call it istishab. So the istishab helped to build that yaqeen, yaqeen, the certainty related to the ruling, you know, and related to certain object or certain item or certain, you know, masair. So that's the source of al-yaqeen la yuzalu bishak. You cannot say, oh, we're using it for this thing, then it changed. You know, I said, no. It's always we have al-istishabu, and that's one of the qaida. And it is qaida on the usul, inshallah, if we'll have the opportunity to study the usul in more elaborate and in depth, we can give more example of that. The second thing, qal, the action of al-mukallif himself or herself. When they have kind of doubt, confusing in cert regulation or cert like ruling. And this principle is related to that. So the example of the tahara, we'll go back always to the example of the tahara, which is the most simple example. If someone is in a state of wudu, you know, when it comes, the doubt is the doubt of related to the person himself. Related to the person. So whether he's going to do wudu or not, he said, don't do wudu as long that you're not certain that you broke your wudu. But you are certain that you did wudu. He said, yes. Then said, based on this principle, you should not do your wudu because you are doubtful. And this doubt that you have will not revoke the certainty that you also have. قال وهذا كله عندما يكون المشكوك في حال قبل الشك فتستصحب ولا ينتقل عنها إلا بيقين. So whatever the person did or has, whatever the person has before the doubt, he will keep what he has before the doubt. It either stays حكم, whatever person he has in his hand. The example, someone, he's sure that he, you know, bought something, you know. And then he saw the same thing like in the hand of his friend. He said, maybe this is not mine, this is my friend's, you know, I should give it back to him. Things like that, you know. So, but he said, but I remember I bought it. This is, you know, I get it home. So that certainty should not revoke the doubt that he has. So he will keep what he's certain with. And this is like just example to throw it to see some of the what the author, you know, want meaning here. But one of the beautiful conclusion here saying, قال ابن القيم رحمه الله said it in بدائع الفوائد. قال ينبغي أن يعلم أنه ليس في الشريعة شيء مشكوك فيه البتة. As a conclusion, we need to know there is nothing in the Sharia that something is doubtful. The doubt only comes from the person, not from the Sharia. The doubt comes from the person, not from the Sharia. So this is concerning al-yaqinu la yuzalu illa la yuzalu bishak. La yuzalu al-yaqinu bishak. The next one, qala rahimahullah. Verse 19, 20, and 21. قال والأصل في مياهنا الطهارة والأرض والثياب والحجارة والحجارة. هنا here there's another principle, and it's very important to know this principle, which help to make easy the way for all the believers. You know, in their life. For example, many people, they say, is this halal or haram? Is this halal or haram? Is this halal or haram? If we'll keep asking this question, we're going to make it like very difficult to ourselves. And many people ask, actually, when they ask the question, they said, that's not the proper way or the approach to approach things. You cannot say, oh, this halal or haram. Well, that question, actually, you're restricting even your action into the society, asking everything is halal or haram. So this principle in the fiqh help to give you, you know, a view or broad view to everything around you, you know, how to approach it. So he said, al-aslu fil-a'yani at-taharatu. الأصل في الأعيان. الأصل like the original state in everything that exists around us is pure, is مباح, is permissible. So I say this is permissible. Unless you stop me, told me it's haram. You find me using it. I said, why are you using this? I said, why should not use it? Said, but this haram. I said, why is haram? I said, the Prophet ﷺ said, don't use this. There's this hukum related to this. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that's how he taught the ummah. قال قل لا أجد فيما أوحي إلي حرام. I don't see any haram except what Allah told me. So the haram is the exception. The haram is not the norm or the standard things. The permissible is the original state of everything. The exception is the haram, except for two things that we're going to study. And one of them is actually, it has a difference of opinion. So, al-aslu fil a'yani tahara. And when you say tahara, something is clean, pure, then it's permissible to use it. قال والأصل في مياهنا الطهارة. So when we turn consider the waters you use, you know, just you don't ask how clean or not, it is pure, unless there is circumstances or a condition that change it to be non-pure. That is will be like something seen, witnessed. And can be observable. قال والأرض and the earth and whatever on top of it والثياب what we use for clothing والحجارة and all the stones around you, everything you can use is halal. قال here قال إن الأصل فيما على الأرض الإباحة. You know, the whatever on the earth, it is permissible to use. Whatever exists on the earth is permissible to use. Which is make, you know, very clear statement for every believer, every Muslim knows everything around you is halal. Do we have a dalil for that? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the beginning of Surah Al-Baqarah, هو الذي خلق لكم ما في الأرض جميعا. He's the one who created to you whatever, everything that is on the earth. Whatever is on the earth, Allah created it for you to benefit of it, for you to use. Therefore, when he said for you, everything that he created is halal. So, everything in the earth and on the earth is permissible to use, including, you know, the water, the thiyab. Thiyab, when we're talking thiyab, everything we use, you know, we'll treat out of plants or we treat out of skins of animals and all of that, subhanAllah, it's halal. It's permissible, mubah. وَكُلُّ ذَلِكَ طَاهَرْ and all of it is pure. When you say pure, it means that it is permissible and lawful to use it. And there is no any opposite opinion or any opinion, conflicting opinion to what we have said among the early scholars. So when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala قال, He's created it for you, as He's saying here, لكم, it means as in Ibn Atiyyah said in his Tafsir Al-Muharrar Al-Wajiz, لكم ملكية, it means like Allah created for you to own and specific for you. So to own and specific for you is to use, and to use it mean Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said this is for you to own. How can Allah give us something to own and specific to humankind when it's not permissible for them to use it? قال وكلاهما يدلان على ملكية بني آدم لما في الأرض واختصاصهم بذلك وليس إلا للإباحة. So this is only mean that it's permissible to use whatever exists on earth. Also, the ayah itself that we have mentioned, قَالَ سِيقَتْ مَسَاقَ الْإِمْتِنَانِ. I mean, the way that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned, so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is showing His favor. He's showing His favor subhanahu wa ta'ala to His servant. In the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, hadith rawahu Abu Darda marfu'an, قَالَ مَا أَحَلَّهُ اللَّهُ فَهُوَ حَلَالٌ وَمَا حَرَّمَهُ اللَّهُ فَهُوَ حَرَامٌ وَمَا سَكَتَ عَنْهُ فَهُوَ عَفُوٌ. In this hadith, the Prophet ﷺ saying, whatever Allah made haram is the haram. And whatever Allah make halal is the halal. And whatever Allah didn't talk about it is afu. What does mean afu? Allah give it to you like, you know, grant it to you. Favor, permissible, don't ask about it. In the other hadith, قَالَ فَاقْبَلُوا مِنَ اللَّهِ عَافِيَتَهُ. So, you know, accept from Allah what He has forgiven, what He has, what He didn't speak about. يقول شيخ الإسلام in مجموع الفتاوى, there's some people they kind of rejected, denied such, you know, opinion, which is, as we said, agreed upon among the whole Salaf. And he said, this is, they do not have any evidence and they do not have any thing to validate such opinion. However, those who said, you know, al-aslu is al-hadr wal-man'u. Al-asl, I mean, before, what is mean al-asl? The origin of things in their only, I mean, things in their original state should not be touched unless to verify that is permissible. When according to our principle that we're studying, that the origin of state of everything, you use it because it's permissible. Now, those who said, you cannot touch anything unless you verify that it's permissible. They actually looking at different perspective, which is the perspective, there's haram things. There are things are poisonous. There are things are like, you know, not permissible. So the scholar here, they answered them, said, you should not look from that perspective. Because anything that is harmful is known already that is harmful. So we are not talking about such a thing. You're not going to see, for example, a snake and you're going to take it as, you know, people, they take a snake as a pet. But, you know, a snake that it has a poison and you get, you know, this is permissible to use, it's going to bite you. And the Prophet ﷺ also put for his ummah a whole principle of la darara wa la dirar. You cannot harm or cause any harm. So when we're talking from the perspective of you know, it might be things that harmful, that's why we need to be you know, kind of precautious in using things, we say no, that's not the right perspective to look at it, because that's an exception and what is hurtful and harmful is known, then we cannot base the principle on such exceptions, and then we be, you know, going back to talk about, like to reiterate that the principle is al-asl fil ashya' al-alibah, that the original state of everything on earth is permissible, is mubah. Well, and mubah قال وما لكم ألا تأكلوا مما ذكر اسم الله عليه وقد فصل لكم ما حرم عليك. Why you not eating from what Allah's name is mentioned on? And Allah already has gave you, revealed to you in details what is haram. So here the ayah itself, the interpretation of the ayah, like everything is halal, except what Allah fassal. Fassal, it means like He showed to you. That's why there's things in Islam that is not allowed to be to have the excuse of ignorance to not know it. Why? Because mufassala, mufassala, it means like being well detailed. And every Muslim who say La ilaha illallah, he know that is haram. When you talk, for example, about alcohol, everyone who comes to Islam, you know that is haram. Why? Because ma'lumun min ad-dini bil-darura. Ma'lumun min ad-dini bil-darura. What is mean ma'lumun min ad-dini bil-darura? And this is, you see this word a lot in the books of Aqidah or in the books of the Usul. Ma'lum min ad-dini bil-darura is like it is obviously known, if you can say, or known by the by necessity of being following this deen, or by obligation, it becomes like obviously known. You know these item, these you know rules are obviously known for whomever accepted Islam. Ma'lumun, if I'll take it word by ma'lumun, known, min ad-dini, from the religion, bil-darura, bil-darura, by necessity, by, you know, it's here necessity, like say, by necessity to come to this deen, you have to know it, you know, which is like an obligation, part of the pillar of the deen, because the pillar of the deen is not like the five pillar of the deen. Say, can we say like one of the pillars of the deen that the alcohol is prohibited? It's not. But whoever come to Islam, he by obligation, he going to hear and know that is haram. So that's ma'lum min ad-dini bil-dharur. Based on that, then the valid opinion and the principle to base on the maxim and here, which is the author mentioning, that قال الأصل في الأشياء هي الإباحة. The original state of everything existing on earth has been the also, as we mentioned, the ayah from Surah Al-Baqarah, that is الإباحة. The ayah from Surah Al-Baqarah, if I... I would like to give you the number of the ayah so it will be easy for you to refer to it, which is هو الذي جاء خلق لكم ما في الأرض جميعا. آية البقرة آية 29. آية 29. Another آية قال وينزل عليكم من السماء ماء من السماء ماء ليطهركم به. And he sent down from the sky a water to purify you with it. So it's pure. كامل is pure. وأنزلنا من السماء طهور من السماء ماء طهور. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم saying when it comes to the earth, قال أعطيت خمسا لم يعطهن أحد قبلي. Allah favored me with five things, no one before me had them. Including قال what he said, قال وجعلت لي الأرض مسجدا وطهورا. The whole earth made to be a place of worship and also to use it for purification, for tayammum. واضح. So all these ahadith showing that everything on earth is in or in its original state is halal, is permissible, and this is the ayah that the principle that he's mentioning. طيب. The next one, قال. I read here, قال اختار شيخ الإسلام ابن تيمية رحمه الله تعالى أن الأصل في المسألة السابقة الإباحة, as we have mentioned, permissible. وطهارة الأرض والثياب والحجارة لمن كان مسلما يعمل الصالحة. لأن إعانة له على الطاعة. And every Muslim who's acting in righteousness, the clothing, the stones, whatever he used from the earth is mubah for him. طيب, the second rule, the second principle, the second maxim in this one here, قال, I read it, which is verse number 20. قال والأصل في الأبضاع واللحوم والنفس والأموال للمعصوم تحريمها حتى يجيء الحل فافهم هداك الله ما يمل. الأصل, the origin, in الأبضاع comes from بضع, and the people they ask, you know, but in the terminology of the fiqh means النكاح is the marriage, means also the intimate relation, and here we're talking about, you know, the relationship that someone will be intending to have with the person. So if someone, for example, they're going to get married, al-abda, it's not anyone that you can get married with. So here, as in the other maxim, what we said, everything is permissible unless is unless it's stipulated otherwise, right? Say this is halal, unless he told me no, this is haram. I said, what is your evidence? He said, because this and this. But when it comes to the abda, when it comes to relationship, when it comes for someone, for example, want to build a relation with a person, he cannot just build the relation. He said, this is it's haram. That's why you call it mahram. Mahram, it means like it's not, you know, haram on them. Unless, you know, it's stipulated otherwise. Because if someone, for example, it's one of his relatives that is mahram, so it would not be possible to build a relation with them. Or a person that he wants, for example, to, you know, people that want to get together, or someone will see a person, you know, that want to approach. But that person is already married. So that person is haram. So when it comes to this subject, someone, he has to first stop to ask, is it halal first? So we say, we put first haram, then we'll ask, is it halal? For everything else, it's halal. Unless we're told is haram. So الأصل في الأبضاع واللحوم, he add also meat. And this is the difference of opinion, we'll study it inshallah. Someone offer you meat, he said, hold on, is this halal? Is this permissible to eat? So this is what it means. Say, for example, say, oh, this person say for you know, to build to have a marriage, first, is this person permissible to initiate a relation with? Maybe she's married, maybe she's in her idda, maybe someone said no, like she's not married. But for example, someone get divorced, okay, did they finish their waiting period? Because if they didn't finish their waiting period, it's still haram to even approach them. قال ولا تواعدوهن سرا الا ان تقولوا قولا معروفا. Even you don't promise them openly. So that's the abda, it's clear, that's, there is no, you know, difference of opinion about that. For the meat, the same thing according to the here to the qawaid, but this is what we're going to study for the meat. قال والنفس, also every soul is haram to touch. Every soul, to bother, to harm, to slay, haram. وَالْأَمْوَالِ لِلْمَعْصُومِ, and everyone's wealth is haram, because he's ma'soom. Ma'soom, it means like he's protected. He's a Muslim, as the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam قال, لَا يَحِلُّ دَمُ الْمُسْلِمِ وَلَا مَالُهُ إِلَّا, except when there's a justification. Justification is the right. You cannot take anything only with its right. قال All of these are haram. The beginning, you know, when you approach them with a perspective that is haram. You cannot touch them. You cannot be, you know, you cannot even get close to them. Unless you will be notified that it's okay to go ahead. You see the difference? The other one, you have the green light to go ahead and take and use. Unless will be stopped to not use it. In these cases that he mentioned, al-abda'u wal-luhum wal-nafs wal-amwal, marriage, and we're talking about, you know, especially here in this case, the women, al-luhum, meat, al-nafs, lives, al-amwal, wealth. When you come to them, do not get close. Unless you will have the permission to go ahead and approach them. Al-ma'soom is the one that is prohibited to touch. And al-ma'soom here, the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, asama is like prohibited, you know, the life, the wealth of a Muslim to be touched, to get even approached, to take it with no way, except with his right. The right here is the justification. Someone, for example, he took a land by force and he said, this is my wealth. As long as he said, this is my property, it's haram even to touch it. But when you have a proof that he's not his, told them, you don't have the right, we're going to take it back. As long as he said, this is mine, this is his property, you cannot touch it. Someone you cannot even touch or bother or slay, you know, how can you, someone, for example, hurt a person with no right? But when you get in the battle, in a battlefield, they're fighting, you're going to say, what's my position now? He said, yes, you have the permission. If they want to kill you, you have the permission to fight and defend yourself. Someone is attacking you. He said, I don't have the permission to touch this person, to hurt this person, but this person is hurting me. Now I have the justification to hurt him back because he wants to hurt me. You see? That's why you see them in the investigation when someone is guilty. He said, no, I was defending myself. They have to prove that they were in a state of defense. I remember in certain cases, someone like he said, I'm defending myself, and he shot the person with, like, you know, 10 bullets. He said, how this is helping, you know? It does not make sense. If you are like defending yourself, it will be done this way. You understand? So it's, there is no way for someone to hurt a person without right. And the right, it's not like you fabricate this right. This right is validated and justified by the law. What? Any question? طيب. قال البضع. It has, as we said, three meanings. The first meaning is al-nikahu. Al-nikahu is the marriage. The second is al-jima'u, the intimate relation. And the other is, when we talk about budha, we're talking about, you know, the more specific thing. طيب. Concerning the meat, قال وأما اللحوم فاستدل بالدليل العقلي السابق عند القائلين بأن الأصل المنع في الأشياء ولكن الذي عليه الأكثر والجمهور هو أن الأصل في اللحوم الحل حتى يجيء المنع. The majority of the scholars, when it comes to the meat is halal. Unless, so the meat, we're going to put it in the first category with the first principle, not with the second one. So when you be offering meat according to the analysis that we have, you accept it. Of course, unless it's a meat is haram. You know, talking like put the haram thing on the side. If it's a pork, meat and everything, you know, don't eat. And then he said, what was that meat? He said that was pork. But as long as the meat, we're talking about halal meat in its origin, halal. قال the analysis as I read here قال إن جنس ذوات اللحوم من الأعيان الموجودة على الأرض فهي داخلة في الإباحة. The kind of the animals that Allah created that the human being are using is part in that ayah that Allah mentioned in Surah Al-Baqarah. He created all of you for you, and he said it in the end of Surah. الله سبحانه قال لهم يروا أن مما عملت أيدينا أنعاما فهم لها مالكون. The ayah in the toward the end of Surah Yasin, Allah shown the favor how He created the cattle for subhanAllah, especially for the human being to have it and to use it. Then Allah سبحانه وتعالى قال وقد فصل لكم ما حرم عليكم. And Allah سبحانه وتعالى he revealed to you and show you in details what he made haram. And Allah سبحانه وتعالى said in the same surah of Al-An'am قال قل لا أجد فيما أوحي إلي محرما على طاعم يطعمه. Say I don't find in whatever was revealed to me haram on anyone who going to eat. طاعم طاعم the one who going to consume, going to eat, except the dead animal, the blood, the pork, and whatever being offered to other than Allah as a worship, as a sacrifice. That's all the haram that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned. So here some of the evidence. قال ويدل على أن الأصل في اللحوم هو الجواز والحل. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the ayah that I have mentioned, Surah Al-An'am 145. قُلْ لَا أَجِدُ فِي مَا أُوحِيَ إِلَيَّ مُحَرَّمًا عَلَىٰ طَاعِمٍ يَطْعَمُهُ إِلَّا أَنْ يَكُونَ مَيْتَهُ أَوْ لَحْمَ خَنْزِيرٍ إِلَىٰ آخِرِهِ. وَيَدُلُّ عَلَيْهِ أَيْضًا قَوْلُهُ جَلَّ وَعَلَىٰ إِنَّمَا حَرَّمَ عَلَيْكُمُ الْمَيْتَةَ. الله إنما أداة حصر. So the tool to restrict from this general food that Allah created to make an exclusion, restriction out of it. And he said, إِنَّمَا إِنَّمَا only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made haram on you this and this and this. And there are four things. فَحَصَرَ الْمُحَرَّمَاتِ بِأَدَاةِ الْإِسْتِثْنَاءِ إِنَّمَا. So Allah limited the muharramat with the adatul istithna, which is the in the language use innama only, innama only haram are these only. So by using only, so Allah defined exactly what is haram. ويدل عليه أيضا ما ورد في السنن من حديث عائشة رضي الله تعالى عنها أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم سئل عن اللحوم التي يؤتى بها إليهم ولا يدرى هل ذكر اسم الله عليها أو لا. And also there's in the Sunan from Hadith Aisha رضي الله تعالى عنها narrating in a hadith that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم was asked about the meat that being offered. They offer them meat, but they don't know what is the state of this meat, whether the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was mentioned on it or not. فقال what the Prophet says, قال سموا الله عليه أنتم وكلوا. You mention the name of Allah on it and eat. And eat. What? فلو كان الأصل في اللحوم التحريم لقيل لا تأكلوا حتى تعلموا قيام سبب الإباحة. So if it was the original state in the meats to be forbidden, so we have to be precautious, stop, and then verify that it's halal. And then it will be like, you know, we cannot eat till, so the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam will have said, no, you have to verify first. But he said, you name the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Of course, here we have to say that the meat of the animal that's been slaughtered, that's a condition that someone needs to ask for it. Why? Why the difference? What is the difference between a slaughtered animal and non-slaughtered animal? The non-slaughtered animal is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, he called it al-mayta, dead animal. So if an animal was killed in a way to turn into dead animal, then that is already excluded from the category of the food that is allowed for us. So that's why I said, you know, when you know in a place that all what they do is the slaughtering, not the killing, slaughtering, it's either it is a law in a country, like the case here, or it's no, like the tradition that they slaughter the animals. So even the, if they didn't mention the name of Allah, you mention the name of Allah as the hadith of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. But if the animal is killed, then it turned to mayta, and you know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala harram al-mayta. Harram al-mayta. Any question? When it comes to the nafs, we mention, قال لا يحل دم امرئ مسلم إلا بإحدى ثلاث. Is not allowed to touch or to hurt a Muslim only in three cases. And he mentioned الثيب الزاني, the one who's commit adultery while they are, you know, already married. والنفس بالنفس, if someone killed a soul, then you apply the law of soul for soul. وَالتَّارِكُ لِدِينِهِ, and the action of apostasy, which is its details in the books of the fiqh, which is not the case to go into detail of that. وَحَدِيثُ جَابِرْ فِي صَحِيحِ مُسْلِمٍ, حَدِيثُ جَابِرْ فِي صَحِيحِ مُسْلِمٍ, the hadith of Jabir in Sahih Muslim, in the Hajjat al-Wada', al-Hajj of al-Wada', the farewell Hajj of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, قال إن دماءكم وأموالكم وأعراضكم عليكم حرام. He said, your blood, your lives, your wealth, your honor, أعراض, your families, your ties, your honors, all of it is haram among you. Which is mean haram? Do not bother it, do not touch it, do not hurt it, do not cause any harm to any life, to any soul. I mean, when you say life is like not killing, I mean, even shedding the blood or hurting a person or hitting it, all is haram. وَأَمْوَالُكُمْ, your wealth, your property. وَأَعْرَاضُكُمْ, is, you know, when we're talking about أعراض, families, honors, and to talk ill about people, to backbite people, to gossip about people, to say, you know, to fabricate falsehood about, you know, the behavior or conduct of people, all of it is haram. So this is, as we said, then to conclude and go to Salat al-Maghrib, insha'Allah ta'ala. Al-Aslu, then the original state of everything on earth is halal, unless otherwise is stated. What is the thing that you need to stop? And it is haram to approach, unless otherwise is stated. When it comes to case of marriages, lives, and properties and wealth. Three things. We exclude the meat because we answer the question, but you find the meat here included, and we have you know, answered that we should pour it with the first category. Any question? Jazakum Allahu khairan. We'll pray and we resume insha'Allah ta'ala at 7:05. Good. That's including the break. طيب 7:05 inshallah. Barakallahu feek. I have salatation.